think that it's important you pay attention to the important words here, because it is only then you would be able to understand what this chapter is trying to explain. So the quote is very important, because we'll come back after reading maybe two pages of the chapter, we'll come back and we'll be able to understand this quote much better. So by the problem of economic development, I mean simply the problem of accounting for the observed pattern across countries and across time. So the problem is of observed pattern across countries and across time. Which pattern are we talking about? We are still not very clear, but we will come to know about it in levels and rates of growth of per capita income. So yeah, so they're talking about the patterns in levels and rates of growth of per capita income. So the absolute level of per capita income as well as the growth rate of per capita income. This may seem too narrow a definition, so there's already a caution there that just focusing on levels and rates of growth of per capita income may seem too narrow a definition, but perhaps it is, and perhaps it is, but thinking about income patterns will necessarily involve us in thinking about many other aspects of societies too. So Lucas is saying that to measure the problem of economic development is simply the problem of accounting for observed patterns in levels and growth of per capita income. Although this may seem too narrow a definition, but the income patterns will necessarily involve us in thinking about many other aspects of societies too. So I would suggest that we withhold judgment on the scope of this definition until we have a clearer idea of where it leads us. So basically this quote perfectly summarizes the idea of at least the first three pages of this chapter, where we are trying to talk about how focusing on just per capita income is more than enough for how we define development. But again, I mean, at the same time, and we'll be more clear about it as it comes. So, but just to keep in mind, we are talking about accounting for the observed patterns in the levels and growth rate of per capita income. So that's a very important line to keep in mind from that quote. All right. So economic development is the primary objective of the world's nations. I am not going to read each and every line, but I would at least expect you to read through the lines when your screen is showing you a certain paragraph or a certain page. Every year, aid is dispersed, investments are undertaken, policies are framed, and elaborate plans are hatched so as to achieve this goal, or at least a step closer to it. But how do we identify whether we are reaching the goals that we have targeted? So definitely, I mean, we know that in every nation is trying to strive for higher and higher growth trajectory, and they are striving for development. And every year, definitely a huge amount of money is being invested in development plans. So how do we know if we are going in the right direction? How do we measure development is a big question. Right, so what characteristics do we use to evaluate the degree of development a country has undergone, or how developed or underdeveloped a country is? So primary question is, how do we measure development? Now, the issue is not so simple to resolve. We all have intuitive notions of development, and we've talked enough about what we exactly include when we talk about development. So in a very layman sense, what do we mean by development? We imagine a society. If we close our eyes and if we try and think of a developed society, what are the things that we'll get in our head? That people are well fed and well clothed, possess access to variety of commodities, have the luxury of some leisure and some entertainment, they live in a healthy environment. We think of a society which is free of violent discrimination, tolerable levels of equality, sick receive proper medical care, people do not have to sleep on the sidewalks. These are the kind of things that we would imagine, and there could be many more things that you could imagine when you think of a developed society. In short, the minimal requirement, these are like the subsistence, the minimalist idea of a developed nation is that physical quality of life is high. So again, I mean, if when we talk about development as a notion, as a concept, when we try and define development, these are the kind of things that we would imagine. We have already talked about education, health, institutions, and a lot more things previously that as an aggregate explains development. So these are the factors that we want to take into consideration when we want to define development. But the problem is that we can't really measure each one of these aspects. So it's difficult to measure education, measure health, measure institutions, measure every possible thing that we try and attach to an idea of developed society. And so that's where the question comes in. It is a problem of accounting of which factor. So that is where the text suggests, the author suggests that we should, our primary focus should be on per capita income, and we'll understand why that suffices as an indicator of development. Of course, the notion of a good society goes further. So definitely, I mean, these, as I said, that these, this is not the exhaustive list of factors that you would want to consider when you're talking about development. The list goes further. We might also stress on political rights and freedoms, intellectual and cultural development, stability of a family, low crime rate, and so on. So there could be multitudes of things that you would have in your head when you think about development. However, a high and an equally accessible, also, please notice that we are at all times so far have been talking about levels and growth rates, as well as so here as well we focus on two things: high and equally accessible levels of material well-being, and this will become clearer towards the end of this discussion, but I'm just highlighting these two terms here. So however, a high and equally accessible level of material well-being is probably a prerequisite for most other kinds of advancement. So what we are saying here is that definitely the list isn't just restricted to these things highlighted in this paragraph. It goes further. It goes out to talking about stability of an economy, political rights, and political freedom. But for all of these factors to come into play, a major prerequisite is material well-being. So this is something that we believe is a necessary condition. So if you talk about in terms of necessary and sufficient conditions, then this is a necessary condition for all of these other things to come into action. So economists and policy makers therefore do well by concentrating on this aspect alone. So, and by this aspect we mean material well-being. So economists and other policy makers believe that just by focusing on this aspect alone, we can define development. It is of course tempting to suggest that the state of material well-being of a nation is captured quite accurately in its per capita gross national product. So that's where we are trying to link these things together. So we are saying that definitely development is a multidimensional, is a holistic concept, and it takes into consideration of a lot of factors. But for all of these different other factors to come into action, material well-being or physical quality of life has to be is a primary element that has to have that we need to have in a society. Now this material well-being, it is quite tempting to suggest that the state of material well-being of a nation is quite accurately captured in its per capita gross national product. Notice we are talking about per capita gross national product because these different economies differ in terms of its sizes, and an economy which is larger than the other economy might have a larger total gross national product, but when you try and take that in terms of per capita, if you take population into consideration, then things might change. So it's important to focus on per capita gross national product when we are trying to compare different economies. We are all aware of the definition of this term, the per head value of final goods and services produced by the people of a country over a given year. So there have been long phases in the history where development performance was judged exclusively by the yardstick of the per capita gross domestic product growth. But in the last few decades, this practice increasingly has come under fire from various quarters, and the debate goes on, as the quotations at the beginning of this chapter suggest. The quotation by Lucas also ends with an open end, because it was saying that unless we get a clearer idea, we have to stick to what we are doing right now. So right now we do talk about development in terms of gross domestic per capita, gross national or gross domestic product, but we need to be very, very careful as students, as budding economists or as students of this course, that no one is suggesting, we are not, when we talk about measuring development by measuring per capita gross domestic product, we are not defining development in that sense. We are not using this term, this notion, as definition of development. So there's a difference between defining development and measuring development, is what I would expect you to understand in this lecture, that we are not defining development in terms of per capita gross domestic product, but because we need to identify a variable or let's say a smaller set of variables which will account for these larger pool of variables. So say you have different variables which you would take into consideration when you are talking about development. So you have these different variables, and you say that together, when these variables are there in the society, then we call that society as a developed society. But the problem here is that it's difficult to analyze and aggregate all these variables into one variable, one index. So what is it? We need to find some smaller set of variables. So we need to find the smaller set of variables which will account for all these variables to properly measure and to track development, is what's something that Lucas is also trying to highlight, that it's important. It's a problem. The problem of economic development is the problem of accounting for the observed patterns in all these variables, but it's difficult to observe patterns in all these variables together. So we need to identify these variables, which are smaller set of variables but are actually going in the same direction as these indicators are. So no one in their right mind would ever suggest that economic development be identified in a definitional sense with the level or growth of per capita. We're not saying that we are defining development as increase in per capita gross national product. We are just using this concept to as the data also suggest, and we'll eventually look at the data also somewhere later in this chapter, that the data suggests that with changes in per capita GDP, you see the right kind of changes in all these different factors as well. So say when we talk about population growth, and we say that decreasing population growth or a controlled level of population is an indicator of a developed society, and we do see that with an increasing level of GDP, there is improvement in population, there is the population changes in that fashion that we would expect it to change in a developed society, and that happens. That is highly correlated with an increase in GDP. If you talk about education, say one of these factors is education, then we do notice that with increase in per capita GDP, education levels increase. You talk about health as the second factor, and then we do see that with increase in per capita GDP, there is an improvement in health indicators. So what we are trying to say here is that by definition, development is a multidimensional concept, and it takes into consideration a lot of different factors. But to measure development, it is for now, at least at the point of time where we are in, it is sufficient. It is okay to measure levels and growths of per capita income and track development by that measure. So just keep this in mind that we are not using per capita GDP in the definitional sense. It is perhaps universally accepted that development is not just about income and has but income has a great deal to do with it. So it is quite important to highlight this line that it is not just about income, but income does have a great deal to do with development. Right, so now in the end, the paragraph talks about how development is also the removal of poverty, undernutrition, increase in life expectancy, and so on. Right. Right, so again, so even the Lucas, at first, if you read out Lucas' quote, then you would feel that he is probably missing out the point. But it is important to understand that even Lucas doesn't believe that per capita income is development. What's hidden in these words is actually an approach and not a definition. So we are talking about an up. So the words that are mentioned in the beginning of the chapter talks about. Indicates an approach and not a definition. It is really a brief belief about the world, which is that universal features of economic development, health, life expectancy, literacy, and so on, follow in some natural way from the growth of per capita GNP. So, as I just said, that we will look at the data of all these indicators and we'll see that there is some kind of correlation and some kind of high level of correlation of all of these factors with growth and level of per capita GNP. But it is important to focus here that this outlook may be contrasted with the view that a correlation between GNP and other desired features is not automatic, and that in many cases such connections may not be present at all. Having said that, having said all of what we have been saying so far, that per capita GNP or per capita GDP sort of is a prerequisite for all other kinds of development, all other kinds of factors of development to come into picture. We're not really saying we want to sort of also keep this in our mind that it is not always true that these connections will be present. So, according to this view, according to this belief that these kind of connections between GNP and other desired features of development may not be present at all, and they are not really automatic. So it's important to supplement per capita GNP. Just focusing on per capita GNP may not be the right idea according to this view, and must be supplemented with other indicators directly. And that's the reason why the shift has also gone towards HDI to measure development rather than just income, because primarily because of this belief that the relation between GNP and other factors may not always be what we expect that to be. So it's important to supplement our notion of our measure of development with other factors as well. So we will in this course also look at how HDI takes into consideration three aspects of development, which is income, health, and education. So we will look at the exact calculation of HDI later in this unit. But there has been a shift towards measuring development through HDI values, just so that we can corroborate with this idea. So it's quite clear so far that the debate implicit is not about what development means. We are not really debating about what development means as a world society as well. I mean, there is no debate about how development is a multidimensional concept and how for any economy to be classified as a developed economy, it is not just important to focus on income, but a lot of other things as well. But what we are really concerned and what we are really debating about is how should we possibly find a smaller set of variables? What are the exact? So I just showed you a rough diagram of what we are trying to understand here. That's basically the debate. Possibly finding a smaller set of variables that correlates well with the multifaceted process of development. So everything that we, every minute possible factor that we are talking about when we talk about development, we want to narrow it down to a smaller set of variables. And that smaller set of variables is a question. What exactly should be the components of that small set, of that small circle, is the primary debatable question in the world economy as well. But we do have some answers as of now. As I just said, that HDI has been proposed by UNDP a few years back, and that is an answer to all of these questions. But this things are still moving ahead. People are still talking about what could be the possible accurate measure of development. But I hope the idea is clear that we are not really defining development by the measure of per capita GNP. But we are just using per capita GNP. Per capita GNP is an approach to measure development and not a definition of development. Just before moving ahead, it's again important to notice that it may be that per capita income does not capture all aspects of development, but a very assertion that no smaller set of variables ever captured the complex nature of the development process, and that there are always other considerations, is not very helpful. So what we are saying is that for now, at least, we do not have an alternative measure to per capita GNP or GDP. We do not have any other alternative as of now. So no other smaller set of variables besides GNP and health and education could ever capture the complex nature of development process. And that's the reason why we are sticking on to per capita income, because it has that feature of concentrating the larger pool into a smaller pool. Okay, so what are we using through in this text is a focus on two variables, not just per capita income, but also on another important variable, which is we have to begin somewhere. So we concentrate implicitly on understanding two sets of connections. One is the average level of economic attainment, which is what's represented by GNP. Okay. And the other connection is how the distribution of economic attainment is. So it's important to look at the average levels of economic development, but it's also important to look at how equally this average level of economic attainment is distributed across the society. So I think somewhere in the text when we are talking about development, let me just check this. There was a focus. Yeah, so there was a focus here in the last page that in short, most of us would insist that a minimal requirement for a developed nation is that physical quality of life be high and be so uniformly rather than being restricted to an incongruously affluent minority. So development is not just about increasing the physical quality of life or maintaining a certain level of life, but it is also that it has to be uniformly distributed. It shouldn't be, and we do see that although we've reached a higher level of development, but the distribution of development is quite sparse and it's non-uniform and it's unequal. There's a high level of inequality across the world economy as well as within nations. It is there across nations as well as within nations. So it's important, and in this chapter we are looking at these two measures as the measures of development. One is the average level of development, which is measured by GNP, and the other is the distribution of economic attainment. Right. Now, so in the first section, we have sort of set this idea, we've believed this idea that we have to measure development with per capita income levels. The next section talks about the measurement issues. So what possibly are the measurement issues when we talk about per capita income as the indicator for measuring or comparing different economies. Now, we all know that different economies have their own currencies. So, per capita incomes would be measured in these different currencies for these different countries. But to make a comparison, it is important to bring them on a common level of measurement. And hence, one possible way to do that is that each country's income, which is in local currency, which is in their own currency, is converted into a common currency. Typically in US dollars, it is converted into US dollars, and divide that with country's population to arrive at the level of per capita income. This conversion scheme is called the exchange rate method. So you usually, I'm sure you all know what an exchange rate is. So you usually have this price of currencies. So say $1 is rupees for the Indian context. Let's say, I don't know what exactly the current number is, but let's say this is $1 is 80 rupees. So what do you do? How do you bring different economies on a same platform? Is that suppose a particular economy's the gross national product level is measured in its local currency, then you use this exchange rate to convert it into dollars, and you do that for all the countries and then make a comparison on which country is developed or less developed and so on. This is called as the exchange rate method. And by this method, in 1993, it was seen that the world produced $24 trillion, and about 20% of this came from low and middle income developing countries, whereas these countries had 85% of the total world population. So in 1993, using this method, which is the exchange rate method, 85% of the world's population just contributed 20% of this total output. So we can imagine how unequal our economy is. Switzerland, which was the world's richest country under this system of measurement in 1993, enjoyed a per capita income close to 400 times that of Tanzania, the world's poorest country, according to this method in this time period. So there was a ratio of 400:1 between the world's poorest and the world's richest and the world's poorest country with this level of measurement. So definitely there's no doubt, there's no question that we are living in a highly unequal society. And this is a chart that shows how per capita income. So this is on the x-axis you have per capita income, and here on the y-axis you have population, and you see that with lower levels of per capita income, there's higher level of population, and as income increases, the population level tends to fall. Okay, so other kind of concerns that we could have, and we should be cautioned for these points when we are talking about development as a measure, income as a measure of development. First is that underreporting of income is very common, especially in developing countries. So we begin with this discussion believing that using the exchange rate method conversion, the ratio between the world's richest and the world's poorest nation in 1993 was 400:1, which is a huge number. So we are trying to sort of think of different, first is that we believe this number. Second is that we do not believe this number. We accept the fact that we are living in an unequal society, but we also want to come to an exact value of an exact measure of this inequality, and we say that it is possible that this number is biased, and there could be different reasons why this number is biased. One is that we question the method that we are using to bring every currency onto a common platform, which is the exchange rate method. So we will have a discussion in some time about whether exchange rate method is the right method to compare different economies. One is that, because the number that we got in 1993, the ratio that we got of 400:1 is a number based on using exchange rate method. So first question is whether we are using the right kind of method when we are making comparisons. Second is the other kinds of concerns that we have when we take income as a measure. First is that in developing countries, underreporting of income is very common because tax collection systems are not as efficient as those in the industrialized market economies. And definitely to sort of evade taxes, people do not report their income appropriately or correctly. And hence, there can be some bias because of this factor as well, because the developing countries are not reporting their actual income levels and they are sort of under-reporting the income levels, which are leading to more and more inequality and more diversion between the world's poorest and the world's richest countries. In addition, the proportion of income that's generated for self-consumption is also high in developing countries. And people living in rural sector in developing countries is also large. These are some facts about developing countries that are quite common. And in this chapter later, we'll empirically set these facts as well. So because of these reasons, income can have this downward bias in developing economies. Okay, so although we can make educated guesses about the degree of underestimation involved, there's really very little that we can do about correcting for this problem. This is the first problem that the text highlights. The second problem, as I was just saying, is with the usage of the method. So as far a far more serious issue comes from the fact that prices for many goods in all countries are not appropriately reflected in the exchange rate. So when we use exchange rate as a method of conversion to bring these economies on a common platform, it is important to note that the exchange rate only takes into account the prices of goods which are internationally traded, and it ignores the prices of goods and services that are not internationally traded. So these exchange rates are decided based on the prices and commodities which cross international borders, and we know that there are a lot of services, a lot of goods that are not internationally traded. The prices of non-traded goods such as infrastructure and many services do not affect exchange rates. And it is important that there is a systematic way in which these non-traded prices also are related to the level of development, which are completely ignored in the exchange rates. So using exchange rates as a method of conversion is questionable, and that also sort of induces some bias in the comparison. Because poor countries are poor, you would expect them to have relatively low prices for non-traded goods, which is true. Their lower real incomes do not suffice to pull these prices up to international levels. So although the prices of certain goods in developing economies might be low, but that doesn't firstly come into the calculation of exchange rates, and hence is ignored completely in the process of in the process of measuring development, because low prices in low income countries do not indicate, may not necessarily indicate, may not necessarily be a signal of lack of development, because if people are getting lower incomes and they do not have to spend a lot on subsistence consumption, then that is not really a signal of underdevelopment. So that has to be taken care of when we are talking about measuring development and bringing economies on a common platform. So if you compare developed economies and developing economies or underdeveloped economies, then definitely the prices of commodities will differ. The cost of living would differ. So although you might get a lot of income, you might have a higher level of income in say an X country which is very developed, but you also have a higher cost of living in this X country which is highly developed. Whereas if you compare it to country Y, which is not so developed, the incomes are low, but at the same time the cost of living is also very low. So that has to be, you have to control for these different cost of living in these different economies, and that is not appropriately done in the exchange rate method, because exchange rate method are only taking into consideration the prices that are in for goods that are internationally traded. We are ignoring goods and services which are not traded, and hence that may not be the most correct method to measure development and compare different economies based on this measure. Okay, so to correct this method, what do we actually use is something called as purchasing power parity measurement of income, which is to bring economies, compare economies. So the idea is to bring all each economy on a common platform. One is that you bring them on a common platform in terms of same currency, convert every currency, every country's total GDP or GNP level into US dollars, and then compare them. We just discussed that how that may not be the right method. So we, what we do is that rather than talking about their same currency, we convert them on same purchasing power levels. So we make sure that if $1 is officially by exchange rate method is equal to 80 rupees, then we, when we talk about purchasing power parity, we actually try and look at how much can $1 buy in US and how much could be bought with this in say Tanzania. So we are looking at the real conversion of this $1 rather than this nominal conversion. When we talk about purchasing power parity, we were trying to understand how much could be bought with $1 in the US economy, which is probably very less, but how much of the commodities could be bought with 80 rupees in say Tanzania or any other country which is not so developed. So this is what we are trying to, and this is something that will sort of bring these countries on a common platform more appropriately than this level of conversion. So this is what we would discuss next. And there's a data set by Hestons and Summers, which was the data that tried to sort of solve for this problem. And by how things changed, obviously it did not eradicate inequality completely, but definitely it brought the level, the difference was sort of minimized, was sort of reduced when we use purchasing power parity as the measure of income. And this is also commonly called as the international comparison program. Okay, so according to the exchange rate calculation, the GDP estimates according to the exchange rate calculation, Asia's weight fell in the world output from 7.9% to 7.2% between 1985 to 1990. And yet Asia was the fastest growing economy during that period. So there were some kinds of definitely some kinds of conflicting results that you saw when the GDP estimates were based on exchange rates calculation. The same period, so you see that the Asia weight fell from 7.9% to 7.2%, but it was also the fastest. You also see that in the same period, there was a sharp decline in some Asian countries' exchange rate against the dollar. So now, I mean, we are able to understand why probably the weight of Asia fell in the world output using the exchange rate calculation, because the some of these countries, you would remember that during 1990s there was a there was a collapse in the East Asian countries where the currencies started depreciating. So the prices of these countries were falling in terms of exchange rates, and that is probably the reason why the income levels of these countries were also falling. Whereas if you look at these economies in terms of their growth rates, then they were the fastest growing economies during this period. So to take into account all these shortcomings of GDP exchange rate estimates, two economists at the University of Pennsylvania, Heston and Summers, created a new data set called the Penn World Tables. And this is a widely used data set for macroeconomists, development economists who are looking at the world economies, which is why this is also called as the Heston Summers data set, because of the creators of the data set, Alan Heston and Robert Summers. The data set consists of a set of national accounts for a very large set of countries dating from 1950. And its unique feature is that the entries are denominated in a set of international prices in a common currency. And we will look at what do we mean by this international price in a common currency. In an exchange rate calculation, this international price is dollar. The currency is dollar and the international price is the exchange rate that we use. In this data set, we calculate an international price and we will look at how this international price is calculated. So I hope you are through with this idea that exchange rate is calculated based on the prices of traded goods. Whereas the problem here is that there could be certain non-traded goods which affect development and are not taken into the calculation of exchange rates. So to counter for that, to cater for this shortcoming, we are in this data set under this program, we are calculating an international price in a common currency. And common currency even in this data set is still dollars, but we are not looking at this conversion of $1 into say 80 rupees, which is the exchange rate. We are calculating the international price by ourselves by taking into consideration even those goods which are not traded across countries. And we'll look at how we do that. So again, in the next para, it just talks about what is the problem with market exchange rates for GDP calculation. So some people also say that using exchange rates for market for GDP calculations is wrong or is possibly not the best method because of its level of volatility or its level of market fluctuations. But that's actually not the right reason, because even if the exchange rates are fluctuating, are volatile, that's probably because the prices are changing, and that is just a correct signal of the market. But the problem here is that they are not fluctuating around the right average. So exchange rate fluctuations is not really a problem for using exchange rates for GDP calculation. The problem here is that exchange rates are fluctuating around the wrong average, or they are not fluctuating around the right average price. And why not the right average price? Because this average price that the exchange rates are fluctuating around is the price of internationally traded goods over time. And it ignores on goods which are not traded. Okay, so this is a UN program. This international comparison program is a UN program, and it was carried out between 1970 and 1985. These are called as Penn World Tables, the PWT tables, which were constructed using this ICP data. Now, what are the steps in this data collection process? So, as a first step, ICP gathered detailed data on prices of 400 to 700 items in each of a set of benchmark countries. So several countries were taken into account, developed, underdeveloped, developing, all set of different kinds of economies were taken into this pool, this set of benchmark countries. And from each of these countries, detailed data on the prices of 400 to 700 items were included in the data set. Then The price of each of these items was divided by its corresponding price in the US. So suppose there is a particular commodity, say a television. So one of the 400-700 items could be television. Now price of television, let's say in the Indian economy is 40,000. And so I will create a data set with different items here, which are 700 items for each of these countries, and the items are common across each country, and I will look at the price of these items in the domestic country. What is the price of this particular item in the domestic country, and what is the price of this particular item in the US economy? And then I will create a relative price for each of these items in the third column by dividing the domestic price by the US price. So the third column will be domestic by US, and that will represent the relative price for each of these 700 items. Then these items were classified into 150 expenditure categories. So these 700 items, these total list of 700 items, were then aggregated into 150 expenditure categories based on the nature of these items. So 150 categories here. The breakup of these categories is also given. 110 categories were consumption categories, 35 categories were investment categories, and 5 categories were government expenditure categories. So based on, so TV would fall under consumption category, any other commodity, say some kind of government expenditure, some infrastructure expenditure, or maybe defense expenditure, any of these expenditures would fall under government expenditure category. And so each of these items, 700 items, were then further brought under these 150 expenditure categories. By an averaging procedure, the average relative price for each category is obtained. Now, for each of these categories, for each of these 150, since there are 700 items and you are classifying them under 150 categories, there will be categories with multiple items. So one category could have, say, several items within it. Now we are looking at the average relative price for each category. Remember, in the first step, we have calculated the average relative price for each of these items. Now the second step is to classify these different items into 150 categories based on the nature of these items. And then we are calculating the average relative price for each category. So say category number one had 3-4 items, and each item, you know the average relative price for each of these items. Please ignore my handwriting here, because I'm just using my laptop touchpad to write this. Okay, so category one had 4 items, and each of these 4 items had their relative prices. We want to calculate the average relative price for this category. So by using some averaging procedure, and we are not really getting into the detailed statistic here, but we just want to have an idea of how this was conducted. So some average procedure, these 4 categories were averaged, these 4 items were averaged, and the average relative prices for these 150 categories were obtained. Talked about how for each of these 150 categories, now we have average relative prices for 150 categories. Next is national currency expenditure. So national currency expenditure, which is PIJ into QIJ, price times quantity for each item I in each benchmark country J. Again, we are talking about items and not categories. On each of the 150 categories is obtained from each country. So this is used to estimate the quantities involved in national output. How are we doing this? So we are dividing the expenditure for each category by its relative price. So say on a particular item I, there is an item I, इस पे आपकी इकोनॉमी ने, डोमेस्टिक इकोनॉमी ने एक्सपेंडिचर करा है इतना, विच इज पी टाइम्स प्राइस ऑफ दिस इन कंट्री जे, प्राइस ऑफ दिस आइटम मल्टीप्लाइड बाय क्वांटिटी प्रोड्यूस्ड ऑफ दिस आइटम आई इन कंट्री जे. दिस विल टेल यू द एक्सपेंडिचर ऑन आइटम आई इन कंट्री जे इन टर्म्स ऑफ कंट्री जेज करेंसी. नाउ यू आर डिवाइडिंग दिस by the relative price जो हमने first step में calculate करी थी. So हर item के लिए हमने relative prices calculate करी थी, which is Pij divided by price of the same item in US economy. So we are dividing this expenditure by this relative price, and you would notice that this is ultimately going to give you the expenditure on this commodity in terms of US prices. So it yields an estimate of the quantity in the category valued at its corresponding US price. So it is important to understand that this ratio Pij into Qij by Pij by PUS is nothing but the value of quantities of different items at US prices. Now next step is that we have 150 category wise relative prices for each country, which we did by the end of the first by the end of the second step for each category. Now so what we had basically 150 relative prices. हमारे पास हर category का relative price है. Now in the next step, in the third step, what we are doing is that for each category, the international relative price is obtained by aggregating the relative price for this category over all benchmark country. So हमारे पास ये जो 150 relative prices हैं, this is available for each country. So this is indexed at country J. So for each country we have 150 category wise relative prices. Now in the third step what we are doing is we are picking out on one category, say one of the consumption categories, and for this category we have the relative price across J countries. If the total number of countries are J, then you have relative prices across these J countries. We are calculating an international relative price, which is what we highlighted in the first page, that we are going to look at the right price. The question that has been raised in the chat section as well, that what is the right price? This is what the right price is, and this is how we are calculating it. So for each of these 150 category, we are looking at the relative price for this category across J countries, and then we are aggregating these different prices across J countries and calculating our relative price. So an international price that we have been talking about is calculated by averaging the price of each country, and this is done category wise. So international relative price is obtained by aggregating the relative price for this category over all benchmark countries based on a method suggested by statistician R.C. Gehry. Now again, I mean, we don't want to get into the mathematical object here, that how exactly this process was done, but there was some kind of averaging process which was adopted. Now this method is such that the international relative price obtained for any item is a specialized weighted average of the relative prices of that item in all the countries in the set. So it is done in a way that it is a weighted average of the relative prices of that item in all countries in the set. So for example, let me get rid of these. So, for example, food is cheaper in a rich country than in a poor country. So, if we believe that food as a product is cheaper in a rich country as compared to a poorer country, the international relative price now, because it is a weighted average of relative prices in each country, the international price of food will be higher than its domestic price in a rich country. If we believe ki rich country mein food ka price kam hai as compared to a poor country, then if you compare, so say food in rich country is 100 and food in poor country is 200. And now, since jo humne international relative price calculate kari hai, wo कंट्री वाइज एग्रीगेट करा है हमने, राइट? सो हमने एक कैटेगरी के लिए डिफरेंट कंट्री के प्राइसेस कैलकुलेट करे हैं और फिर हमने इन सारी कंट्रीज का एग्रीगेट करा है. सो यू विल हैव दीज प्राइसेस आल्सो, जहां पे रिच कंट्रीज होंगी जिसका फूड प्राइस कम होगा, यू विल हैव पुअर कंट्रीज आल्सो जिनका फूड प्राइस ज्यादा होगा. इंटरनेशनल प्राइस कैसे कैलकुलेट करा है? बाय टेकिंग एन एवरेज ऑफ दीज पुअर एंड रिच कंट्रीज, विच विल गिव यू हाउ मच, 150. दिस इज जस्ट अ हाइपोथेटिकल एग्जाम्पल, but this is not the exact process jo yahan par hua hai. I'm just giving you an example so that you understand the meaning of this line. So you notice here that the international price comes out to be 150 because it is weighing for these different economies as well. So now if you compare the price of food in the rich country with the international price, you will notice that the international price of food tends to be higher than its domestic price in a rich country. Whereas for a poor country it is lesser, because poor country mein food ka price domestic price zyada hai, to international price se wo kam hai. International price poor country ke domestic price se kam hai, whereas if you compare international price of food with the domestic price of food in a rich country, then the international price of food is higher than the domestic price of food in the rich country. Similarly, at the same time, international price of investment is lower than in a rich country. So, depending on, so you are basically trying to say ki jo aap international price calculate kar rahe ho, usme aapne har economy ke price level ko control kiya hai, usko include kiya hai, and hence it is a more representative number of the world economy. बिकॉज अगर किसी कंट्री में फूड का प्राइस कम है, किसी कंट्री में फूड का प्राइस ज़्यादा है, एंड यू आर सॉर्ट ऑफ एवरेजिंग ऑल दीज डिफरेंट काइंड ऑफ प्राइसिस, देन दिस इंटरनेशनल प्राइस इज अ मोर रिप्रेजेंटेटिव फिगर. सो नाउ वॉट यू डू, सो इन दिस पैराग्राफ वेयर वी वर टॉकिंग अबाउट द क्वान्टिटीज ऑब्टेन्ड फ्रॉम द एक्सपेंडिचर डेटा, नाउ वी आर वैल्यूइंग दैम एट दीज इंटरनेशनल प्राइसिस. सो इंस्टेड ऑफ वैल्यूइंग outputs at the exchange rate, we are valuing output at this international price. So suppose $1 was 80 rupees. Now what we are doing here is we are value, and suppose aapka national output tha say 400 units, then initially aap kya kar rahe the, 400 into 80. Ab aap kya kar rahe ho, aap har category ka रिलेटिव प्राइस निकाल रहे हो. यू आर डूइंग दिस अक्रॉस डिफरेंट कैटेगरीज. अब आप हर कैटेगरी का रिलेटिव प्राइस निकाल रहे हो और उस कैटेगरी में जितना भी क्वांटिटी प्रोड्यूस हुआ है उसको उसके इंटरनेशनल प्राइस से मल्टीप्लाई कर रहे हो, एंड दिस इज हाउ यू आर कैलकुलेटिंग द टोटल इनकम इन दिस मेथड, विच इज द परचेजिंग पावर पैरिटी. I mean, you are trying to make sure that this international price takes into consideration the representative prices of the world economy. So it will have in feature the lower prices of a rich country, also it will have the component of the higher prices of a poor country, and then you are doing this across different categories. Jo 150 categories form kari hai aapne, uske across in international prices ko calculate kara hai, and across categories jitna bhi quantity produce hua hai uska corresponding expenditure aapne कैलकुलेट करें. आई विल जस्ट गेट रिड ऑफ ऑल ऑफ दिस. Okay, and then using these benchmark countries for other countries, the data was extrapolated. There were certain countries which might have not been included in this exercise, and then the other countries were also brought into consideration by extrapolating the data from this exercise. The PWT data also offers data on capital stocks and demographic statistics. Now, with the revision in GDP calculation, you see that the position of the countries have changed slightly. So this is the exchange rate method, and this is the PPP method. And you see that the ranking of the countries has changed here when we try and use the PPP prices rather than exchange prices. So Asia's share in the world output in 1990 jumped from 7 to 18%. Whereas initially, when you begin this discussion, we saw that the Asia's output actually fell. But when we use PPP method, we see that it actually increased from 7 to 18%. China emerges as the world's third largest economy, and India comes in at the fifth place. This is backed at the data from 1990. US remains the world's largest economy, irrespective of whether you take the PPP method or the exchange rate method. But I'm sure the difference between probably US and China or US and India might have reduced with the inclusion of PPP prices. So this is the graph that shows the merging and how the inequalities, again, as I said, the inequalities will not get eradicated completely, but the inequalities would definitely get minimized. So you see that this darker curve here represents the PPP measurement, whereas this lighter curve represents the exchange rate. So this curve represents the exchange rate measurement of income, whereas this represents the PPP measurement. And you will notice that the lower income economies have actually increased, the income of these economies have increased vis-a-vis the exchange rate calculation, whereas the higher income economies, the incomes of these economies have fallen with PPP measurement. So definitely the inequalities, the steepness of the curve has reduced for the PPP calculation vis-a-vis the exchange rate calculation. So there definitely still is inequality. So if you look at the poorest economies per capita income and the richest economies per capita income, there is still some inequality. But if you compare this with exchange rate calculation, then definitely the inequality has reduced. So the basic idea of this section was to understand that although we are using income as the measure for development, we need to also consider the concerns that one might have when we take income as a measure. So this is one important factor that has to be considered when we are talking about using income as a measuring tool for development. And in this section, you basically talk about how PPP estimates go some way toward reducing the astonishing disparities. They go only some way, they have not reduced the disparities completely, because that's not the fact. Disparities are still there. We're just saying that PPP shows the accurate extent, accurate measure of disparities. Okay, the third point is there are subtle problems of measurement. GNP measurement, when it accounts for the exchange rate market exchange rate problem, uses market prices to compare apples and oranges, that is to convert highly disparate disparate goods into a common currency. The theoretical justification for this is that market prices reflect people's preferences as well as relative scarcity. So another problem with using market prices is that we believe that the markets are perfectly competitive and the markets have presented us the prices which represent the actual people's preferences and that represents relative scarcities. But this may not be true in all kinds of markets, because firstly, not all markets are perfectly competitive, neither all prices are fully flexible. So when we talk about market prices also, we are not sure whether the market prices are actually reflecting the level of scarcities and level of people's preferences or not, which optimally it should represent. Any price should represent the consumer's preferences and relative scarcities. But are we sure whether the market prices are reflecting that? We are not, because firstly, not all prices are competitive. There are different other kinds of market structures that we have which are existent. So we are not sure if the market prices are the correct, if they show the correct significance of that particular product. There is expenditure by the government on bureaucracy, on the military, or on space research, whose monetary value may not reflect the true value of these services to the citizens. So say government spends a huge sum of money on military, space research, defense, but their monetary value may not really reflect people's preferences or may not really reflect the level of scarcities that we have for these commodities. So it is not always true that the market prices are reflective of the true market scenario. Also, there is recently has also been a concern on externalities. So prices, market prices also ignore. So GNP and most conventional measures of GNP ignore costs that arise from externalities. So the cost of associated pollution. So say you are producing trillions of industrial commodities, but the market prices of these trillion production that you have done for the industrial commodities is ignoring the cost of pollution that it has created as externality. So that is being ignored in the conventional measures of GNP, and that's also something that we should be cautious of when we talk about development, because as we are repeatedly saying that development is a holistic concept, and to measure that concept in an appropriate way, we need to consider all these factors as well. So say a US, which we consider as a developed economy, is producing a lot of say some industrial commodities, and that is adding on to their GNP. But they are also creating, at the same time, they are also creating a lot of externality in terms of pollution. Are we, so in that sense, maybe it is not developed. The monetary value of these industrial commodities doesn't reflect the true picture, because ideally, with the increasing level of pollution that the industrial production is creating, the amount of development should fall, because if we should ideally also consider the cost of pollution in the prices, which is also called as the social price for any commodity. There's something called as the price, market price, and there's something called as the social price, because this social price is also taking into consideration the prices of externalities. So maybe the 200 trillion economy, the 200 trillion production is worth 150 trillion production. Because if we try and reduce the cost of pollution that it has created, then the value should fall. Because we are not really talking about monetary growth here, we are talking about development. So it's important that we also take into account these different costs of externalities, environmental damage, resource depletion, human suffering due to displacement caused by development projects such as dams and railways. Again, there is a huge amount of displacement that happens when any kind of development project comes into action. So are we taking into account the cost associated with these factors? Not really. In the conventional measures of GNP, we ignore these factors. So that is also something that we should be cautious about when we are trying to compare economies based on income levels. So as I said, prevalent prices do not capture the true marginal social value. They do not capture the social prices. So there have been some sophisticated measures of development that have been suggested.
So something called as shadow prices are used by so this is shadow prices may not always be equal to the market prices, because shadow prices take into consideration the actual marginal values and actual cost, and these are prices which you get when you, I mean, these are the actual correct market prices for any commodity, because they take into consideration every possible cost. So they take into consideration the cost of pollution, cost of any kind of externality, and exact level of marginal values. So you can impute the GDP by calculating the GDP at these shadow prices. So we can get rid of this problem by using some more fancier versions of GDP measures rather than just looking at the conventional measures. So when we try and compare economies based on development indicators, it is important to not just restrict ourselves to the conventional measures, but also to look at these enhanced, these fancier versions of measures of development, which take into account the shadow prices of commodities. And again, I mean, there's a vast literature theoretically and empirically that deals with the concepts and techniques that we need to calculate shadow prices for different commodities. Green GDP, which has also recently become very famous, is one example of these fancier versions of GDP, which takes into account the prices of any kind of environmental damage that has been done with any kind of production that's taken into account in the GDP calculation. So this section basically ends with this point that when we take income as the benchmark measure of GDP, we need to be very, very cautious with all these points. And when we compare economies based on the level of income, we have to take into consideration the method that we are using to calculate, to compare economies, whether we are using the PPP method or not, and whether we are taking into account the true social values, true social costs of the prices, and also taking into account the underreporting. So these are the three major concerns that the author raises with using income as a measure of economic development. Next is the historical experience. I don't think we have time to cover this. So we'll resume from here in the next class.